Hello and welcome to Dental Studies Simplified. I'm Dr. Ankita Kotecha, and in today's video we will discuss the treatment of gummy smile. One of the treatment of gummy smile. As already discussed in the previous video, there are various etiologies, various reasons for a gummy smile, and hence the treatment varies as per the etiology. So in today's video we will discuss one of the treatment according to one of the etiologies, and that etiology is altered passive eruption. Now, as elaboratively discussed by Coslett et al, who explained that there are two categories of APE, type 1 and type 2, based on the two main parameters, that is the width of keratinized tissue and the distance between CEJ and bone crest. So, under type 1 we have, there is a wide zone of keratinized tissue, and here we have normal or narrow width. Clear? This is the first parameter based on which we have type 1 and type 2. And again under type 1 and type 2 respectively we have two subgroups A and B, on the basis of the distance between CEJ and bone crest. If that distance is adequate, that is more than or equal to 2 mm, then it is A, subgroup A. If the distance between bone and CEJ is greater than or equal to 2 mm, then it is subgroup A, and if it is less than 2 mm, or the bone crest and CEJ are on the same point, then it is subgroup B. This must be clear, and it is just a revision so that today's video is easy to understand. Clear? Why this elaboration? Because now, based on these four categories, type 1A, 1B, 2A and 2B, the treatment varies. How? There is a wide zone of gingiva, keratinized tissue, and plus the distance is adequate. So here we will perform gingivectomy followed by gingivoplasty, because it's an aesthetic procedure. Clear? So crown lengthening by gingivectomy. Again, before discussing crown lengthening, aesthetic crown lengthening, I will also discuss crown lengthening in itself is a vast topic, because there are different types of crown lengthening and different techniques to perform crown lengthening. We'll go back to this classification first and then discuss crown lengthening in brief once again. Okay. So now here, wide zone of keratinized gingiva and adequate distance between bone and CEJ. So we will perform crown lengthening by gingivectomy, that is only soft tissue manipulation, the apical shift of the soft tissue margin only. But if that distance is less, so because we have a wide zone of keratinized tissue, we have the opportunity to shift the soft tissue margin apically. But in doing so, we should not violate the biological width, which is 2.04 mm plus 1 mm of sulcus depth, at least 1 mm of sulcus depth. So, if we manipulate soft tissue margin, that is shift it apically by gingivectomy only, this is possible because the distance between CEJ and bone is greater than or equal to 2 mm. So, we will not violate the biological width. But if that distance is less, we will definitely encroach on the biological width, and that is why in this case we should perform soft tissue manipulation plus hard tissue manipulation as well, that is a flap surgery which involves submarginal internal bevel incision. Because we have a wide zone of keratinous tissue, we can afford to reset some amount of marginal tissue to get that thin beveled flap margins, which are good for closure and approximation. Clear? So just because we have this advantage of a wide zone of keratinized tissue, we will perform a flap which involves a submarginal internal bevel incision plus osseous reduction because we have a lesser distance between CEJ and bone, so as to establish appropriate biological width, because biological width violation in itself will create another set of problems which are not good enough. Clear? So this is how type 1 is treated. If adequate distance between CEJ and bone, gingivectomy, that is only soft tissue manipulation. But if inadequate distance, we have to perform both soft tissue and hard tissue manipulation, that is shifting them apically, because APE means shorter clinical crown. So we are trying to increase the length of the clinical crowns to its normal values. Okay, this is about type 1. Now talking about type 2, where we have normal or narrow width of attached gingiva, keratinized gingiva. Again, under narrow width means there is only one surgical flap technique which has an added advantage of increase in the width of attached gingiva, that is apically repositioned flap, APF. Clear? So if it is a narrow width of attached gingiva or keratinized gingiva, we should try and perform a flap technique which will give us the benefit of increasing the width also, and that technique is apically positioned flap. So how to decide whether we should do bone reduction or no, based on its subgroup, that is the distance between CEJ and bone. If the distance is adequate and we perform apical positioning flap, we will not encroach on the biological width because the distance is adequate. But if the same distance, that is between CEJ and bone crest, is inadequate and we perform only apically positioned flap, then we will violate the biological width definitely. That is why in that case we have to perform apically positioned flap plus osseous reduction or bone reduction. Such a very simple concept. If adequate width of attached gingiva and adequate distance, only soft tissue manipulation will work. But if inadequate distance between CEJ and bone, then we have to reduce bone so as to provide space for the biological width establishment. This is a clear-cut explanation of treatment of APE, altered passive eruption. So gingivectomy is performed as per the rules of gingivectomy, very commonly external bevel gingivectomy. Sometimes if there is a problem with the pigmentation, usually in the dark skinned individuals, their gums are also darkly pigmented. Everybody's are pigmented, but theirs are more darker. In such cases, doing external bevel gingivectomy will lead to a pink gums, because that pigmentation will take time to reform. And in that case, in cases with dark skinned individuals, gingivectomy will lead to formation of pink gums rather than dark gums which they already have, which matches the tone of their skin. In such case, doing gingivectomy, external bevel gingivectomy, will lead to more unesthetic results. In such cases, we should prefer internal bevel gingivectomy, internal bevel, so that the pigmentation post-operative, post-surgical pigmentation is avoided. Clear? So gingivectomy is performed as per the rules of gingivectomy. I will try and discuss gingivectomy in a separate video, but for now we will discuss flap plus osseous reduction. Apically positioned flap is also discussed in a separate video when we were discussing surgical flap techniques, and apically positioned flap with osseous reduction. This portion is also discussed in that same video. So for today's video, we will discuss crown lengthening by flap surgery involving osseous reduction. There are few differences while we perform crown lengthening by these flap techniques, be it any flap or apically positioned flap which involves osseous reduction. The principles of osseous reductions are also different when it comes to aesthetic crown lengthening, rather than doing this surgical technique for periodontal pockets or periodontal disease. There are variations which we will discuss as and when we discuss the technique, particularly for aesthetic crown lengthening. So now we will discuss, out of all these four options, treatment options, we will discuss flap technique plus osseous reduction, which will lead to aesthetic crown lengthening in case with altered passive eruption. So now we will discuss crown lengthening for the category type 1 subgroup B. Before discussing this crown lengthening, let us discuss crown lengthening briefly. Crown lengthening is a procedure. The name itself suggests crown lengthening. That means we will lengthen the crowns by two methods. There are apical positioning of the flap, that is shifting the gingival margin apically, shifting the gingival margin apically, or else shifting the incisor margin coronally, incisally or occlusally. So examples of apically shifting the gingival margin involves all the techniques that we just discussed, gingivectomy or flap with or without osseous reduction, and bringing this incisal margin occlusally, incisally or coronally involves a forced tooth eruption or other such orthodontic tooth movement. So crown lengthening has various techniques by which it can be performed, and mainly there are two purposes for which crown lengthening can be performed. That is why we have two types of crown lengthening. Don't get confused between types of crown lengthening and the techniques for crown lengthening. Types are aesthetic crown lengthening and functional crown lengthening. Aesthetics means crown lengthening done solely for aesthetic purpose. There is no enhancement of functionality. It is purely for aesthetic purpose. And functional crown lengthening means some tooth which is badly carious and after the root canal treatment and tooth preparation, there is hardly any supragingival structure which will be able to retain or accept the new prosthesis. In such cases, we perform crown lengthening so that the tooth can functional properly. So crown lengthening aimed at increasing or enhancing the functionality of the tooth, the function of the tooth, is called functional crown lengthening. And crown lengthening aimed at enhancement of aesthetics is called aesthetic crown lengthening. So here we will be discussing only aesthetic crown lengthening. Do let me know if you want me to discuss crown lengthening, that is both the types of crown lengthening. Right now we will be discussing aesthetic crown lengthening. If you want me to discuss functional crown lengthening as well, do let me know in the comment section below or on my various social media platforms, and I will do the needful. So with this video we will discuss aesthetic crown lengthening type 1 subgroup B. Means there is adequate width of attached gingiva or keratinized gingiva, but the distance between bone and CEJ is less than 2 mm or minima. So on this picture, let's say these are the roots. And here is the mucogingival junction. This is the marginal gingiva. So the width of keratinized gingiva, that is both attached gingiva and the marginal gingiva, is adequate, seems to be adequate. And subgroup B means the distance between CEJ. So let's say with a different color we will denote CEJ. Let's say this is our CEJ here and the bone is somewhere here in between. So let's say this is the bone margin just beneath the sulcus. The sulcus ends and the bone crest begins. This is the bony margin. So the distance between bone and CEJ is less. This is the case scenario type 1 subgroup B. So here the treatment plan is flap with osseous reduction. Okay. Now listen very carefully. This is not going to be any ordinary flap. Of course we will apply the principles of periodontal flap surgery only, but it is here, it is going to be a combination. It is not like a simple full thickness mucoperiosteal flap is reflected. No, this is, please keep in mind, aesthetic crown lengthening. We are not treating pockets or any other periodontal disease. We are treating purely an aesthetic problem, that is a gummy smile. So here in this case, gummy smile due to altered passive eruption. So let us show the gingival margins, the free gingival margin over here. So that means the crowns look shorter clinically appreciable. This is the free gingival margin. This is CEJ. This is the demarcation between marginal gingiva and attached gingiva. And this green color is the bone. So the keratinized tissue is adequate, and the distance between CEJ and bone is inadequate, and that is why it is type 1 subgroup B, where we perform flap and osseous reduction. So now on to this picture, we will give incisions. The incisions are going to be only horizontal incision, and the flap reflection will be a combination, that is a combination of both full thickness flap reflection and partial thickness flap reflection. Incision is going to be just one horizontal incision, so you may call it an envelope flap technique, but remember, it is not a completely full thickness or a mucoperiosteal flap reflection. It is going to be combination. Where all we are going to give full thickness and where all we are going to give partial thickness, we will discuss now. So full thickness flap reflection on the buccal side and partial thickness flap reflection onto the interproximal side, and the interproximal papilla are to be kept intact. Remember, aesthetic crown lengthening, so the utmost concern is interdental papilla is kept intact. So I will just list out the rules to be followed while giving incisions and doing the flap reflection for aesthetic crown lengthening. The first and the most important rule is interdental papilla is kept intact. Remember, we are doing aesthetic crown lengthening by shifting the free gingival margin apically. So if we shift this gingival margin apically, if we give a regular incision for full thickness mucoperiosteal flap reflection, then this interdental papilla will also shift apically along with the free gingival margin, right? But this contact point is not going to go anywhere. This contact point will remain at the same place. But if the interdental papilla shifts apically while giving our incisions and reflection, then in the due course of treating one aesthetic problem, we will create another aesthetic problem, that is black triangles, as already discussed in the previous video. Remember the first video on black triangles? Black triangles are caused by periodontal disease and by the treatment of periodontal disease, that is post flap surgery. During healing, interdental tissues also shrink, and that is why they recede apically and creates black triangle. So because we are performing an aesthetic treatment, aesthetic procedure, our aim should be interdental papilla are kept intact. So this interdental papilla is preserved. We are not going to touch them. Literally, we are not going to touch them. Our incisions will be scalloped or horizontal, however you feel appropriate. I prefer scallop because it helps us maintain the architecture, the scalloping of the normal scalloping, clear? So scalloped horizontal incision, which is scalloped and internal bevel. Now again, under internal bevel, we have three types: submarginal, crestal or marginal, and sulcular. Now how to decide when to give which is already discussed in my video, basic incisions, that is horizontal incisions in periodontal surgery. It takes into consideration transgingival probing, width of keratinized gingiva, and sometimes palatal wall. But here, because aesthetic crown lengthening is confined to only facial aspect, aesthetics, why should we manipulate the palatal or the lingual aspect? Aesthetics is purely the frontal, the labial aspects. So this surgical technique is performed only on the labial or the facial aspects of the teeth and anterior. Now how much of the anterior teeth? Usually anteriors are canine to canine, but the smile varies from person to person. Usually it shows premolars to premolars. In some people it shows molars as well. Like in my case, when I smile, I show molar to molar. So decide the horizontal extension of the smile in that patient, in that case per se, how much is their smile extension. So if they show premolars, then add plus one tooth on both the sides horizontal, because we are giving only one horizontal incision. So the horizontal extension is horizontal extension, one tooth additional on both the sides, plus one tooth each side. Okay, so first point is interdental papillar kept intact, no full thickness, partial thickness, nothing, they are just left intact. Second is the horizontal extension on each side. If it is premolar to premolar, involve the second premolar to second premolar. If they show two second premolars, involve first molar to first molar. And if they show first molar, involve second molar to second molar. But preserving the interdental papilla. So this is the first rule. Second rule is the horizontal incision. Now the third rule is the flap technique. Full thickness plus partial thickness. Now where all full thickness? Buccal aspect or labial aspect, and partial thickness on the interdental papilla aspect. So this root portion aspect, that is facial aspect, we will reflect full thickness, but on the interdental aspect we will reflect partially. It will be alternatively full thickness, partial thickness. I will just briefly draw the incisions. Now let's see here, as discussed, the internal bevel incision. Here we have type 1, means wider width of attached gingiva. So we can give internal bevel incision which is submarginal. So let's say as per this level of the gingival margin, our incision goes somewhere with CEJ as a reference. We will give our incisions submarginal. Okay, and it will end here. Because remember, we are preserving the interdental papilla. Again, preserve the interdental papilla. Preserve the interdental papilla and go. Like this, our internal bevel incision will be performed. But our blade will be manipulated alternately, because on the facial aspect, we will give full thickness. That means we will hit the bone. But on the interdental papilla, it will be a little manipulation to give partial thickness. Again, hit the bone for full thickness. Interdental papilla, partial thickness. Again, full thickness for the facial aspect, and interdental papilla, partial thickness. So, full thickness, partial thickness, full thickness, partial thickness, like that. This is the way how flap technique is performed here, because it is aesthetic crown lengthening and not a pocket therapy. Okay. So this is how just one single horizontal incision is given, no vertical incisions, because it is type 1 subgroup B. If it was apically positioned flap, we would have given vertical releasing incisions. But because it is type 1, where we have wider zone of attached gingiva or keratinized gingiva, there is no need of apical positioning of the flap. Already we are shifting the margin, free gingival margin, apically by giving one submarginal internal bevel incision. So sufficient internal bevel incision with osseous reduction because it is subgroup B. Clear? So this is like internal bevel gingivectomy, which involves osseous reduction. So type 1 is sorted by this internal bevel incision. But if you can appreciate from this case scenario, I'll draw the bone crest as well. So the bone crest is somewhere here, very near to CEJ. So now after this incision, if you can appreciate, the distance has reduced. So that means we are now violated the biological width, that is 2.04 mm plus 1 mm of sulcus depth, so 3 mm. Okay. So this distance between the bone crest and CEJ is less. And now with this internal bevel incision, the distance or the entire biologic width attachment is now disturbed. So to now rectify that disturbance, we will now shift this green, this bone margin apically. We already shifted soft tissue margin apically by internal bevel incision. Now to rectify this distance, we will shift the bone crest margin apically by osseous reduction. So now where all to perform osseous reduction, that is also varying in this case particularly. So on to this diagram we will discuss osseous reduction. Again, for osseous reduction there are certain rules. Osseous reduction is performed only on the facial aspect. So I will draw the original outline here first, and then we will discuss the altered one. Clear? So the original outline is as follows. Only the original outline to avoid any confusion. Please note the interdental papilla is kept intact. So this is the original outline. Now we will perform osseous reduction. The osseous reduction with the blue line. I am showing osseous reduction with blue line. Only facial, in that facial also or buccal also, only mid buccal aspect, and just finishing it towards the line angles. Remember, here it is partial thickness because we don't have to manipulate the interdental zone at all. Remember, the interdental papilla is based on the support of its underlying hard tissue. The underlying hard tissue supports the overlying soft tissue. If the underlying hard tissue is reduced or manipulated, the overlying soft tissue will also reduce or get manipulated accordingly. Let's say if this is the underlying bone and this is our interdental papilla, if that bone is reduced, how do you think this interdental papilla is going to stay there? This interdental papilla will also ultimately recede and take support and will remain as much only as much as the support is available to it from its underlying hard tissue. So understood, this is the hard tissue, that is bone, and this is the soft tissue papilla. If the hard tissue recedes, the soft tissue also recedes or reduces. So that is why we have given partial thickness flap reflection in the interdental zone, because we are not going to manipulate the interdental zone at all. And additionally, we have kept the interdental papilla very much intact, no partial thickness also there. Okay, and why we want osseous reduction is required only on the facial or the buccal aspect. That is why full thickness flap reflection also only on the facial and buccal aspects. There is no osseous reduction done in the interproximal region. That is why we have performed partial thickness flap reflection in the interdental region, because we don't want to manipulate bone there. So we kept it pretty much covered by periosteum and connective tissue bed. I hope this flap combination technique is now clear to you all, because our purpose are also pertaining to only facial aspect and not the interproximal aspect. Because it is aesthetic, the interdental zone is kept intact, is kept covered with at least periosteum and connective tissue bed. Okay, and because it is crown lengthening, somehow we will lengthen the crown. So that zone is only facial or the labial aspects. So now on to this diagram, the osseous reduction is performed only in the mid buccal aspect, like this, from the line angles to the line angles. That is only mid buccal or mid facial aspects, and just finishing it onto the line angles, like this. This is how crown lengthening is performed. I hope the crown lengthening is now getting clear to you all. The osseous reduction from green margin to blue margin. This much bone is reduced. So now the new bone margin is here, and this is the CEJ. So the distance is now adequate and biological width will be re-established. So this is how bone reduction is done with carbide and diamond burrs. Now that this flap is reflected, and remember this interdental papilla are intact here, and bone reduction is done. I'll repeat once again, case scenario, flaps, incision and reflection, and bone reduction only mid facial or mid buccal aspect, finishing towards the line angles, and nothing to do with the interproximal region. Anyways, you can't do anything in the interproximal region because it is partial reflection. What will you do with the periosteum and connective tissue? Nothing. The bone is accessible only onto the facial aspect. In that also, only mid facial or mid buccal aspect is trimmed or reduced. and the bony architecture, the scalloping is adjusted by finishing it with the line angles only, and don't dare to touch the interproximal region. Otherwise, I've already told you, by in due course of treating one aesthetic problem, we will surely create another aesthetic problem, that is black triangle, and we don't want that, because in every video where we discussed interdental papilla, I have many times told reconstruction of interdental papilla till today it is the most difficult job. So please do not try to manipulate interdental papilla whenever it comes to aesthetic procedures. Clear? So I hope the incisions, flap reflection is clear, now the bone reduction is clear, and now the final step, suturing. Here the suturing is also going to be a different one. Don't worry, the technique is familiar. Regular interrupted sutures or sling sutures are not done here. Here the sutures given are, remember, this interdental papilla is intact and the flap will be positioned. So here we have to give horizontal sutures, because papilla is preserved there. With the engaging the papilla, we have to give either horizontal sutures or intrapapillary sutures. But make sure the sutures are not too tight. We don't want the papilla to get compressed, because we know the vascularity of interdental papilla is a very critical one. Very limited vascularity, and we have reflected the flap and kept this triangular interdental papilla intact. So the vascularity of the interdental papilla shouldn't be hampered. That is why the sutures are given in such a way that there is not much of compression. Usually we should not give so tight sutures, but here we should take special care. So now you appreciate, this is the gingival margin here, and now the margin with the blue color, the margin is shifted a little apically, and I will draw the suture line separately. I am drawing the marginal line right now. If you can appreciate, the crown has lengthened. Please excuse my diagrams. I really hope the message is conveyed. But this is the final margin. Just appreciate the crown lengthening first. And here. This length and this length. So the crown lengthening is achieved. Now I will show the suturing line. So suturing line, because the interdental papilla was kept intact, the suturing line is somewhere here, and it is going to be horizontal matres suture or intrapapillary suture, which are not too tight, not too much of compression to allow the vascularity to re-establish after the suturing is done. One important point to note here, you remember we have given internal bevel incision, so some portion of the flap is marginally resected. So because we have given partial thickness flap here interdentally, that some portion of the partial thickness flap in the interdental papilla may tend to remain exposed. But we have to ensure by our suturing method that there is proper approximation, and hence such suturing technique which allows approximation of that partial thickness flap and this entire interdental papilla. So after the crown lengthening, please ensure that there is hardly any exposed regions. Clear? So this is how crown lengthening is performed. Suturing is done, and periodontal dressing is concerned, it is totally optional and in my opinion not required as such. Followed by one another important point, a second surgical visit has to be scheduled based on which technique is performed. Like if it is only soft tissue manipulation, then it can be a few weeks. But if it is involving hard tissue manipulation, that is osseous reduction, then it has to be more than 6 weeks, definitely up to 6 months, depends on the bone healing, which is checked radiographically. Once the healing looks stable, then we have to perform a second surgical visit for gingivoplasty. Because remember, aesthetic surgery, so this entire smile line which was manipulated and shifted apically to lengthen the crowns That smile line is a fine adjustment. This was gross adjustment. That gingivoplasty is fine adjustment of this aesthetic smile line. So this is how aesthetic crown lengthening is performed. I hope this procedure, this technique is clear to all of you. But if you still have any doubts or any queries, do let me know in the comment section below or mail it to my email ID dentalstudiesimplified@gmail.com. The next video we will discuss tissue engineering. I really don't know how many videos it will take, but we will start with enamel matrix proteins. Let's see how far or how long it takes. And please do let me know if you want me to discuss the other treatment plans as well. Thank you for watching and listening to me. Study well. Have a good day. Stay safe.